to Liberty.me is the Charm Offensive. I am your host, Tiffany Madison. You can find this interview and more at my publishing site, tiffanymadison.liberty.me. Today we are talking to Justin Hanners, a former Auburn Police Department whistleblower. He was actually an honorable officer of the law, essentially fired for refusing to follow wrongful orders, all over ticket quotas, which is something that almost every American police department has. He's also the author of A Liberty.me Guide, How to Deal with the Police. Welcome, Justin.
Hey, thanks. Appreciate you having me.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So first things first, we'll just jump right in. Many viewers are unaware of your story. Can you share a little of your background as a law enforcement officer and also explain how you became a whistleblower?
Sure. I was an Air Force veteran, security forces. It's my military police security. Law enforcement is what I've always wanted to do. So I got out of the Air Force. I joined the police department in 06. And things were okay at first. You know, there was some minor issues, but things kept trucking along. Then we got a new chief of police, and shortly after he came in, they told us that we, on average, had to have 2 tickets a day and 2 warnings a day. And we were told that if we didn't, that we would be ultimately fired, that we wouldn't get promoted, we wouldn't get pay raises, we'd get disciplinary acts against us, and eventually we'd get the boot. At this time, you know, I expressed my concern with it to my supervisors. They ordered me to write a special report, basically giving, you know, my opinion of why I have a problem with their ticket policy, and also to list other officers by name who felt the same way. Well, I wrote it, and I refused to rat out other officers because I knew it was just going to be a witch hunt. And immediately after that, I was suspended for something I had said 6 or 7 months earlier. And, it was a clear message to sit down and shut up. So after that, I got moved to bike patrol on the university campus. And, again, you know, things got quiet for a little bit. I've been praised by supervisors, praised by the public. And we had a new sergeant that came to our shift, and he started telling officers he was about to have this new policy where we had to have 100 contacts a month. Only 40 of those could be warnings for traffic, and the other 60 had to either be tickets, arrests, non-traffic citations like littering tickets, minor possession of alcohol, or field interviews like Terry stops, stopping people on sidewalk, patting them down, checking them for weapons and warrants. And so I recorded him at the next roll call meeting where he explained it to us. I filed a grievance within the department. They started telling my partner to separate himself from me because I was going to get the hammer dropped on me. I started, you know, getting backlash and retaliation immediately. I went to the Alabama Ethics Commission, the Attorney General, the District Attorney, the Federal EEOC, the Southern States Police Benevolence Association, and ultimately I was fired. And we had a lawsuit in federal court, and it was just dismissed like last week. They said that, you know, the Alabama state whistleblower law only pertains to state employees. Me being a municipal police officer, I had no protection under the law, so basically they can retaliate against me and, you know, fire me for big problems. There's just no remedy under law to protect me. So,
wow, that's unfortunate. And you're going to appeal?
We're talking about now. My attorneys are willing to. We just got to look at, you know, the likelihood of you know, success and you know, what all it's going to entail. It's tough because when we lost this first one, the city has now ordered me to pay, or the court has ordered me to pay for the city's attorney, their legal fees, court costs, and all that. So if I appeal again and lose, then that'll be additional costs. And we've already had our home foreclosed on. We're about broke. So fortunately, my attorneys are taking it pro bono. So we'll just see. We're weighing out the pros and cons and seeing where we can go from there. So.
Well, we definitely like to keep tabs on your story and update people, especially after this interview. So that took a lot of moral courage. I commend you and your integrity. Many officers supported you when you came forward to, you know, kind of your vocal disapproval. You had contact on Facebook, through email, I hear. So obviously, there are other people who don't agree with these immoral and poor policing policies. If they feel the same way, why do you think there are not more whistleblowers or cops that come forward?
Well, I think a lot of them know that they'll end up like me. You know, my career's ruined. I've been blacklisted from law enforcement. What little retirement I had in the system was gone, paying bills. I lost my home. You know, my family's been scrutinized and attacked by the city's local, you know, media, you know, their cheerleaders and things. And, you know, it's just a very stressful, hard thing to go through. And, you know, municipalities are very good at covering their butts and, you know, and twisting the narrative. So, you know, if you speak out, you know, anything you've ever done wrong, no matter how slight, they're going to bring up, they're going to paint a very different picture from you than they would if you were on their side. Say you were involved in a use of force incident, they'll say, oh, he's a great officer, never in trouble. But if you speak out against him, oh, he's a problem. He's been disciplined all these times and things. And it's just tough, especially in Alabama now that, that it's official, though there's no remedy under law, that municipal officers aren't protected, you probably won't see another whistleblower unless it's something extreme. So,
yeah, which is the opposite of what we need. So, question for you. Oftentimes, people are either pro-police or very anti-police, and I'm of the opinion that there are good officers, and you're an example of that as well. I know personally several that I respect and admire who do what they can within the system to fight back against, you know, corruption and their own other officers that are not good officers. What do you think the ratio is between those officers that want to protect and serve versus those that actually seek a law enforcement career to have power over others?
You're going to see the vast majority of them are good people, and a very few that are the bully with a badge type that we all you know disapprove of and don't like. But the problem is the people that will play the game and will push the revenue generating policies that will push the system are the ones that move up and get promoted. So what you see is a lot of bullies at the top who either you know suppress or subdue those that want to speak out or you know do community based policing, and they just the system perpetuates. So. So I would think most are good people, but you know their hands are tied to a degree. They do what they can do as an individual on the beat to take care of the public, but the administrators they've started looking at police departments as a revenue generating force, and you know your options are either to silently leave or try to rock the boat and get you know hammered. So you know most of them are going to try to keep their head down, stay out of trouble, and get that retirement in and move on. So
yeah. That's actually a really good insight. So let's talk about Ferguson, Missouri. At this time, civil disorder and the protests over the shooting death of Michael Brown have calmed. But from this, the reality of police militarization has become public discussion. Some elected officials are even moving in Washington to suspend the transfer of heavy war equipment to local police departments, ending a pretty Orwellian practice of heavily arming these small town cops. Do you think this effort is likely to succeed with public pressure, or are police apologists and unions going to volley for continuing to get these arms?
I don't think it'll change. I mean, you've got the you know the military-industrial complex, and now you've got the mini little brother, the police military-industrial complex. You know, there's a lot of things since 9/11 that were put in place to put these kind of equipment in officers' hands, and now you know a lot of it's tied to the drug war. You know, if you are arresting people for drug charges, you get federal grants for this equipment to do these busts and things, you know, where if you're going to serve a warrant on a rapist or a murderer, you won't get the same funding, basically. So as long as departments still get money and grants and weapons to get these weapons, and it works for these, you know, the drug trading type things, which push that whole war on drugs, I think it'll keep continuing. I don't think that anything will change from the top down from Washington. I don't think there's any pressure that us as good officers or the public can do to change it at this point.
Well, thank you for your honest assessment.
I know this belief, and I hide it now.
Yeah, no, that's great. That's great. So you actually wrote one of Liberty.me's most popular guides, How to Deal with Police. You begin with 3 points advising citizens how to interact with the police. You encourage them to use, record the encounter. You also advise to always be respectful and calm, even if the officer is not. You also say that when questioned, not to give them anything to use against you, that officers will lie and manipulate to entrap you. What are the most common tactics officers use to invalidate constitutional rights, even during a routine traffic stop, in your experience, and how can citizens protect themselves?
Well, you know, like I said, they absolutely can lie to you, and they'll tell you things like, you know, look, you know, I'm just trying to humor my supervisors, just, you know, or they'll say, if you don't answer this, I'll arrest you. So they'll either use, you know, the rod or the carrot. They'll either try to act like they're your buddy, that, you know, that it's just routine and, you know, they're just going through the motions, or they'll act like, you know, they've got you on some other more serious charge, and if you don't cooperate, then it's going to be a lot worse for you. The best thing you can do if you're on a traffic stop type situation where you're pulled over on the road and they're trying to grill you and get more than that is just basically say, you know, am I being detained? You know, if so, what for? You know, and if not, issue me a citation for whatever I've done wrong and let me go my way. And then, you know, exercise rights as far as remaining silent and having counsel and things like that. And you hit it earlier, but make sure if you can, and it's legal in your state, to record. I wish every department required officers to have body mics to record every encounter. Every time that's happened, you know, police use of force has gone down drastically. We're looking at like 80-90%, you know, complaints against officers have gone down, and it's just an honest witness, you know, and it needs to be happening. This incident with Ferguson, if it was recorded, we wouldn't have so much gray area and so much, you know, mistrust between the police and public. So.
Yeah, I'm a big advocate for that as well. I also value privacy, and one of the main rebuttals that I've always gotten from officers or those who support law enforcement over the public is that officers are constantly in situations where other people need privacy. So they're coming into domestic violence situations, they're coming into, you know, murders firsthand, and that it's actually violating the public's privacy by having a constant recorder at all times. What do you say to people who advocate that position?
That's an interesting position. But anything that's a part of an active investigation, they use that as an excuse to not release things like shooting videos and stuff all the time anyway. So if they can use that to cover their own officers that are using use of force situations, why can't that be used to protect a victim's rights? Victims already have rights. Anything that's insensitive to them or violates their right to privacy is protected from Freedom of Information Acts and things like that. So I think that's a moot point. So
yeah, I would agree with you. let's talk solutions. So do you think the privatization of police forces, which would also break, you know, the monopoly on force that officers have, would eliminate much of the corruption that's endemic within these departments? Do you foresee that option ever coming to fruition? And if so, under what circumstances?
God, I hope so. I mean, if you can directly fire your policing agency and hire an entirely new one, then that's a lot of incentive. What you do is you put the police department directly in the hands of the people again, and you get that government by the consent of governed again. Whereas now, you know, your police chief, he's not directly elected by the people. He's buried in the public safety department. So trying to oust him, you might have to oust the mayor, the public safety director, the city manager. And he's just got too many layers of protection. He's not directly beholden to the public. So, you know, I hope that'll come to play, and I think that'll definitely fix it and be a wake up to law enforcement community. But as far as to what it'll take to get it done, I mean, that's just tough. I mean, we've seen a lot of unarmed people get killed by police officers recently for just minor offenses. The gentleman in New York, he was choked to death for selling loose cigarettes, basically, you know, unarmed. You know, this shooting in, you know, Ferguson, and it's just, if things like this don't fix it, and the racial disparagement and things and sentencing, and if that won't do it, then I don't know what will. So I think the biggest thing now would be just the education of the public as an option, and then maybe seeing a good city step out on faith and try it and see where it goes, and maybe that'll be a model that can be emulated. So
yeah, that's with Detroit in its current situation, that's one thing that may start occurring there. I know there's already some options. Because the local government is failed wholly across the board and ripped off the taxpayer. So now the only options is alternative policing. Okay, great. Well, what's next for you? How can people support you? I know that you said that you're not doing legal fundraising anymore, but how can people support you in your mission and message?
Well, just mainly spread the word. You know, there's a lot of YouTube videos, spread interviews like this, and, just as you encounter things, record officers, and if you see something, say something. And, you know, if you know law enforcement officers who are working, encourage them to make that choice. You know, if you know somebody that's about to go in law enforcement, you know, let them know that as soon as you wear that badge, you're going to be pulled two ways. You're going to either be asked to serve your administrators or serve the public, and you've got to make that choice before you ever don that uniform. And like I said, I think we just need to reach out to the good law enforcement and the good officers, reach out to the public, and we have to start bridging that gap and get rid of that us and them mindset. So, as far as supporting me, you know, just your prayers and thoughts, and just spreading the word is the main thing. So,
yeah, thank you. I often say that the last thing that the good officers want is for you to apologize for the bad officers. And that's, you know, we're trying to stop that, really. That's the last thing they need, because there's no then distinction made between what's good and what's bad in law enforcement.
Oh, absolutely.
So. Yeah. Well, this is very insightful. Thank you, Justin. For those interested in Justin's guide, you can download it from the links below. Justin also has a Facebook page, Citizens Behind Officer Justin Hanners. I encourage you to like that page. I'm sure he'll be updating any of his future work there. And if you enjoyed this interview, take Justin's advice, share the word, like, share, and subscribe. Thank you.
Thanks, Tiffany. Appreciate it.